Okay, I think we'll get started. Class may be lightly attended because of the lab who was doing yesterday night, but let's start anyway. Okay, so last time we were talking about consistency models, and I went through a whole slew of them, starting with strict consistency, which was the strongest form of consistency, and we saw relatively and we progressively weakened the model until we ended up with eventual consistency, which is a very weak form of consistency. And what it simply says is there is no real guarantee on when a write or an update made to any data item gets sent to all of the replicas. If there are no more updates, eventually all the replicas will become consistent with respect to one another, but that may take a long period of time. So so that's where we were there. And I introduced this notion of epidemic protocols, which are a class of techniques that are used to implement eventual consistency. Right? So there are many, many systems today that you will see, like maybe everything from Dropbox, or if you have anything that will do cloud synchronization, all of those techniques actually are based on this notion of epidemic protocols, which is based also then based on this notion of eventual consistency. This was designed, or the idea came out in 20 or 30 years ago when researchers at Xerox PARC built a system called Bayou. Bayou was essentially a distributed system that involved mobile devices or laptops. And back then, and which is still the case today, laptops basically were not always connected to the network because they were inherently mobile. So if you took a machine and went home or went on a trip, you may be disconnected from the network for some arbitrary period of time and then you reconnect. Okay. So the point was, what happens when you are essentially disconnected from the network? If the server actually sees any updates, it can no longer contact you because you're not even connected. So you cannot provide any guarantees when you do not have any network connectivity. So they said, let's think of this guarantee and the consistency mechanism as being eventually consistent. Eventually, when you reconnect, you will get the updates and be consistent. Okay, so I mentioned this notion of why this is called epidemic protocol. It comes from this theory of epidemics or spreading diseases. So essentially what happens in most epidemic protocols is there is a pairwise exchange of updates. The two machines, when they connect to one another for any reason as part of some application message exchange, they will also exchange data updates, saying you can send me whatever new updates you've seen and I'll send you whatever updates you've seen. And essentially they do this pairwise exchange. Okay? So essentially this is the same as if you are sick and then how you might spread germs to other people. Okay, so essentially you come into contact with someone else, you infect them, and then they might do the same to others, and then the germ spreads across a population, just as an update spreads across replicas. Okay. So essentially this uses pairwise exchange, and I'm going to talk about two specific techniques for spreading epidemic. These are two different algorithms within the class of epidemic protocol. And the first one is called anti-entropy. Okay, this one is very straightforward. So in this case, a server P will pick another server Q at random. So assume there are n nodes in your distributed system. A node will randomly pick another node, okay, and it will connect to that node and they will do pairwise exchange. Okay, so essentially there are three kinds of exchanges that could happen. Push, where P will say, here are changes I have seen, and push it to Q. Okay? Pull, where P will ask you, have you seen any updates since the last time we interacted, and then pull updates. And both push and pull, where P sends updates to P, Q, and Q sends updates to P. Okay? So essentially you can have push, pull, or both push and pull. Okay? Now, depending on what variant you pick, you will get different variants of anti-entropy. Okay? So you're trying to spread updates through the system. Now, you could start with either a pure push or a pure pull approach, and depending on what is which one you pick, there are certain properties you will see based on how quickly the update will spread. So here is a claim which I'm not going to prove, but we'll talk why that's maybe the case. So if you use a pure push approach, okay, it says that you will not be able to spread updates quickly. And the question is, why might that be the case? So let us assume that you have n nodes in a distributed system. Okay, you basically contact one, they're all replicas. You contact one of the replica and you update, let's say they are database replica. You contact one of the database replica and you update the record. Okay? And it's going to use push-based anti-entropy to spread that update. Okay? So that machine will then at some point contact any arbitrary other database replica and say, here is the record. So now the record has been sent to one more update, one more machine. Those two will then contact two more after some time, and then they'll spread the updates. Now four of the machines have it, and so on. Okay? So initially the update will spread very quickly because no one has it. So every time you contact some node, you will essentially find a node that hasn't seen the update, and then you can keep doing this. Okay? Now, after a while, when some reasonable number of replicas have seen it, okay, that probability of spreading the update starts going down further into the system. Okay? This is because when you pick another node at random, the chances that you will pick another node that has already seen this update is high. Okay, because let's say 80% of the nodes have seen the update, 20% haven't seen the update. And you are doing pure push. Okay, so when a machine contacts another machine, okay, the chances of picking a machine in the 80% pool is higher than in the 20 because you're picking at random. So essentially, as the number of the update spread, the probability that you can spread it to the small number of replicas that haven't seen it starts going down, because every time you pick a node, you pick one that's already seen. Okay, so there may be a small number of nodes that remain that basically have never seen the update. Okay, so that's basically what this says. Use a pure push-based approach. Initially, you will see a lot of updates, but then after a while, it doesn't. Okay, pull-based is the opposite. Okay. Pull-based has a startup problem, because in a pull-based approach, a node P contacts another node Q at random and says, do you have any new data? Okay. Let's say initially there's only one machine that has the data at all. Okay. If a machine I picks another machine J at random and say you have that data, okay, the probability of pick that one node that has actually seen the update is 1 over n. Okay. So with high likelihood, when n is large, you'll pick nodes that have not seen the update. So P will contact a node saying, do you have any updates? Q, the other node will say no, and then they will just go back, and then you'll keep doing this. Okay. Can only when you actually first pick a node, happen to pick that one node that you actually seen the update, will you fetch the update using pull. Okay. So and in the beginning, in a pure pull-based approach, spreading updates is harder. Okay. But if a large number of nodes have already seen the update, then the small number of nodes that haven't seen it can pull it quickly, because when those nodes contact another node at random and say, have you seen the update, with high likelihood you'll pick one that has actually seen the update. Okay? So push and pull will have complementary properties. Push will be good at the start, but is not able to finish spreading the updates to everyone. Pull has opposite problem. It's hard to actually get started. Okay, but once the update is spread, it's very easy to finish. Okay, so that is why it basically says that if you have initial push that is combined with pull, that if you do both push and pull, then you have the best of all worlds. So you need push will actually help you in the beginning, and pull will help you wrap this up by getting the updates to everyone. Okay, so this is essentially anti-entropy. Okay? The other technique is called rumor mongering. It's also called gossiping. Okay, so there is, when you hear about gossip protocols in distributed systems, essentially they're talking about this class of protocol, which is a class of epidemic protocol. Okay, so in this, the way you have to think about it is this is how rumors spread. Okay, so let's say you have some hot gossip item. Okay, so what do? Okay, you might actually call all your friends and try to tell them about this new gossip item you learned. Okay? Or maybe you might post it on your Facebook page or some such thing and try to spread it. Okay? So you will do this for some period of time until you figure out that this gossip item is now stale. Everyone knows about it. So you're not going to repeatedly try to tell someone that I learned such and such. Okay, something that might be a piece of news that is essentially gossip. Okay? And so that is the rationale that is based on, that rumor mongering is based on. So essentially what happens is, upon receiving an update, so initially it is a push-based approach. Okay? So when you receive an update, P is going to pick a node Q at random and try to basically push that update. Okay, this is essentially a piece of gossip, which is a hot item that needs to be spread across the entire system. And then, so you do this repeatedly. You pick a node Q at random, and then you try to push that data. And if you pick a node that has already seen the update, then you toss a coin. And with probability K, you say that this piece of data is already spread to the system, so I'm going to stop spreading it. Just as how you stop spreading gossip items, if you think that everyone knows about it, then you don't tell them anymore, you just stop. Same is true here. If you contact a node and they already heard this piece of gossip, which means they already seen this update, you toss a coin. So with probability 1 over K, you will stop spreading. And K can be tuned. If K is equal to 2, then you toss a coin. With probability half, you will continue. With probability half, you will stop. Okay, if you decide to continue, you will do this. Every time you encounter a node that has seen this, okay, you will toss a coin and say, should I stop? Okay, so you can tune the value of K to say how aggressively you want to back off from spreading a gossip or how aggressively you want to keep spreading even if you are encountering nodes that have seen the item. Okay. So it's a push-based protocol. Okay, that's essentially gossip-driven. Okay, so it's analogous to hot gossip item, which is you spread the item if you think it's now no longer hot, it's become cold. Okay, in this case, because it's a pure push-based approach, there is some non-zero probability that all the nodes that have the gossip item will just back off and not spread it anymore. So there might be some small number of nodes that haven't received it at all. Okay? And if you analyze the technique, which I won't do here, but there is a paper that can show you, you'll see that the probability of staying susceptible is e to the power k minus k plus 1 times 1 minus s. Okay? So it's an exponential 1 over e exponent probability. And there is some non-zero probability here, and it is dependent on K, which is how aggressively do you back off or continue spreading. Okay. But in this case, there's always a non-zero probability that some nodes will never actually become consistent because you completely stop spreading the data item to other nodes at all. Okay? Any questions on this? Okay. So we talked about epidemic protocols and two classes of them. One is anti-entropy, which could be push-based, pull-based, or both. And then we looked at gossip-based protocols, and we looked at one which is called rumor-mongering, the simplest one. And essentially, as a push-based protocol with probabilistic backoff. Okay? All right. So, now, one problem in all of these epidemic protocols is deletion of data is actually a non-trivial problem. Okay? You might actually have seen this even in Dropbox sometimes. Okay, so Dropbox, as you can imagine, actually is based on epidemic protocol. Okay? Your server, your Dropbox client, it will periodically contact the server. If you made changes locally, it will send it to the server. If server has seen those changes, any changes from other Dropbox client, it will fetch it. So it is both using push and pull. Okay, so it is essentially using this exact protocol that we just talked about. And there are many other techniques that, many other applications that do exactly that. Okay, anytime you have cloud-based synchronization, this is a popular protocol that is used for synchronizing data across machines. Yeah. But now, one thing to keep in mind is deleting data in epidemic protocol is a non-trivial problem. So let's say you want to delete a file, it's a Dropbox folder. Okay. Let's say when you start off, your machine and the cloud is completely synchronized. They have the exact same set of files. Okay. You decide to delete a file. Okay. You just delete it from your Dropbox folder. Now at some later point, your machine is going to contact a Dropbox server and try to do the pairwise exchange, which will say what files do you have that I don't have and what file do I have that you don't have. Okay? So if you simply do a diff, what will happen is you will see that the server has that file foo that you deleted and you don't have that file. Okay? So if you do pairwise exchange, the server will say you don't have foo and it will send you that file and the file will reappear on your machine. Okay? So basically essentially when you delete a file and you actually remove all record of it, you don't know whether it has been deleted or you never had it in the first place. All you know is you have a folder that doesn't have that file or you have a database that doesn't have that record. Okay, so when you do pairwise exchange, you cannot figure this out. You might just assume that machine just has some data you don't have and its file reappears. Okay? And early versions of these protocols had exactly that problem. You would delete it, and the file would just magically reappear, and then you would think, why did it reappear? Okay. Now, the way you actually deal with this is you use what is called death certificate, which means when you delete a file, you don't actually simply delete it from your file system. You keep a record, which is like a death certificate saying, I had file foo, it was deleted at this time. Okay. So deletion essentially becomes an update where you zeroed out the file. Okay. So death certificates can then also spread to the system as if they're updates. So when you try to synchronize with the server, you will tell the server, I have a new version, no new update for foo, which is it got deleted. And you pass that death certificate instead of recreating that file. Okay. So that's the way you're essentially going to then ensure that data actually gets deleted through the system. Clearly, this is going to, over long periods of time, you'll accumulate lots of death certificates or old files that have been deleted or not in the system. So every once in a while, you have to go and clean up the death certificate themselves. Okay? Because once you've spread that update everywhere, there's no use for it. The file will not reappear after that time. Okay? So these are all additional details you have to deal with when you talk about epidemic protocols and deletions as a special case of an update. Okay, any questions here? All right, so I'm going to talk about implementation, but only one type of consistency protocol implementation, and we'll defer some of the other discussion to distributed file systems that's coming in a class or two. Okay, so we have covered this whole gamut of protocol guarantees of strict linearizability and sequential consistency, and we ended up with eventual consistency. Okay, none of those techniques actually told you how to implement any of that. At least in epidemic protocol, we saw a little bit about how you could implement, but in the rest of it, we never did. And then you also have to think about how are you going to go and implement some of these ideas. Okay, so there are two ways you can implement any consistency protocol. Okay, one is called primary-based protocol, the other is called replicated write protocol. In a primary-based protocol, every data item in the system has a coordinator or a master node that keeps track of what is the latest version of this data, which nodes in the system have copies of the data. And whenever any updates are made, you always send it to the master node, and the master node is responsible for spreading that update to all the replicas based on whatever consistency guarantees you want, whether it's strict or causal or any of those things. Okay? So every data item will essentially have a primary. The primary is going to be responsible for consistency. Okay, so all modern file systems, not all, many modern file systems use primary-based protocol. The primary happens to be a server, and if the server itself is replicated, you have one server designated as a primary for every directory or every file. Okay, when you update the file, you would actually send the updates to that server. That server will spread the update. Okay. Do cache invalidate or whatever else you need to do. Okay, so that's called primary based. And I'll talk about this in more detail when we come to file systems, because that's a better way to discuss these ideas. Okay. But what I'll instead spend maybe a couple of slides on is to talk about replicated write protocol. A replicated write protocol implements consistency with no coordinator or no primary at all. Okay, there are a bunch of replicas. They are all equal, like peers. Okay. You're going to be able to make writes on any of them and reads from any of them. And you want to ensure consistency, which means if you read, you want the most recent version. If, let's say, you want to implement something like a strict consistency, or if you write, you want to write to enough so that you do not have inconsistencies in the system. Okay? So no primary is assumed, and reads and writes can take place at any replica. I'm going to show you a class of techniques, okay, which will actually do this. I'm going to ignore the primary base, and we'll come back to this when we talk about distributed file system. Okay. So let's now look at replicated write protocols. Okay. So the assumption is we have a set of nodes. Let's say they are nodes of a database, okay, or nodes of a file system. They have replicated data. We'll assume that there's no primary for any of the data item. Okay. And now we want to ensure that when you update the file or when you read the file, you get the most recent copy. How do you do that in this case? Okay. We are going to essentially use this notion of a quorum or voting to ensure that you will always be able to do things in a consistent fashion. Okay. So what this means is every time you do a read or a write, you are not going to make that read or a write request from a single node in the server. You are going to send your read or write request to actually agree or vote on what is the right thing to do, and based on that you will actually decide, okay, this is the right version. Okay, so the simplest thing we can assume for example to understand this example is that there is a single file that is replicated across n nodes. Okay, every time you update the file, you increment a version number. The file has a version number. Okay, and every time you increment the file, you update the version number. The version number could simply be the last modification timestamp on the file. That's a version number. Okay, but for simplicity, we'll just assume it's an integer version number. It doesn't really matter what the version number is. And our goal is to ensure that when you try to read a file, you will get the latest copy. Okay. So that's what I said here. Yeah, consider a file replicated on n servers. You want to now read or write. Okay. And every read request for this, because there's no primary, every read request is going to go to some subset of the servers. Okay. And we'll define this notion of a quorum. Okay. We'll have a read quorum and a write quorum. Okay. So if you have a read quorum of, let's say, 3, let's say you just say read quorum is 3 servers, that means every read request has to be sent to 3 of the n servers in the system, and those 3 servers have to agree on this is the most recent version of the file and give you that version. Okay. And when the write quorum, let's say you have a write quorum of n, okay, or no, n is the total number of servers, let's say write quorum is nw, you are going to send a write request to nw servers every time they all have to perform the write. Okay, I'm going to show you an example in the next slide. And to ensure consistency, so I'm going to talk about a protocol called the Giffords quorum protocol. And what this protocol says is that you can't pick your read quorum and write quorum arbitrarily. If you want to ensure consistency, you have to follow these two rules. Okay? This says that the write quorum has to be a strict majority. Okay, if you have n servers in the system, every write has to go to more than n over 2. Okay? You can pick any number greater than n over 2. So it has to be a strict majority, okay, to ensure consistency. So if you have 10 servers, okay, each write has to be performed at least 6 servers. So if you pick 6 as your write quorum, every write request will go to 6 servers. Okay, and all those 6 servers will then have the most recent version of the file. Okay. So that's what the write quorum says. And then it says, given a write quorum that you have chosen, you have to pick your read quorum such that nr plus nw exceeds n. Okay, so I'll show you some examples of how to do this. So essentially, when you do a write, you will then contact NW servers and get them to do an update. When you do a read, you essentially contact any NR servers in the pool and say, what's the most recent version number you have? And if the version number agrees, then you say, okay, they have the most recent. It's guaranteed that that's the most recent version of the file. Okay, and here is an example just to make us understand this a little better. Okay, so we have servers A through L, okay, 12 servers in our pool. Okay, let's just assume there's one file that is replicated on all 12 servers. Every time you update a file, you increment a version number, which is a timestamp, could be an integer timestamp. Okay, to read, okay, you have to contact NR servers and say, what's the timestamp that you have? Then they'll each tell you the timestamp. If the timestamps agree, you are guaranteed that that's the most recent version. The timestamp disagree, okay, then you repeat, you find another NR servers until you find all NR servers that are in agreement. Okay, so that's, and then to write, you're going to send your write request to NW servers and they'll just make an update. Okay, so here are several scenarios. Okay, the first scenario, we pick the read quorum to be 3. Okay, we pick the write quorum to be 10. Okay, what that means is every write request has to go to 10 arbitrarily chosen server out of 12. Can pick any 10 out of 12, you send the write request there. Okay, and then those servers will perform the write. To do a read, you have to pick any 3 servers. Okay, if those 3 and say, what's the version you have? If those 3 servers return you all identical version numbers, you are guaranteed now that your file is actually up to date. If not, then you will repeat. Okay, and here is an example. So this dotted box here shows you the write quorum for the most recent write. So other than A and B, all the other servers have seen the most recent version. A and B haven't seen it, which means they have some old data. Okay, they didn't see the write. Okay. So to do a read, you pick A, B, and C. And you said, what's the most recent version do you have? A and B are going to send you some old version number, and C is going to send you a new version number. Okay, version numbers won't match. because A and B did not see the red. So you will see this, I cannot actually proceed because they don't agree. The voting has failed. Okay, so you will repeat. You will find another three servers at random. Okay, if you happen to pick three servers in this dotted pool, you will get agreement because all those servers have seen the most recent, right? They will give you the same version number. And you are guaranteed that if the version number agrees, that's the most recent version. So you will just read and you will be done. Okay? So you will see that this has a safety thing built in. Because you picked the read and write quorum this way, there's never a way you can actually go and read and find NR servers that all agree, but you still get an old version. Okay? To do that, you have to follow these two rules. If you don't, then you will actually not get that property, which is the right quorum has to be strict majority, NR plus NW has to be greater than N. Okay? And I'll give you another example where you might actually see this problem. Okay? So in this case, NW is 6. Okay? So you picked half the servers out of 12 to perform your write. NR is set to 7. Okay? So again, the dotted set of servers are the ones that you performed the write on. Okay, so essentially I, J, K, L, H, and D have seen the write. Okay, you now pick 7 servers and you ask for the file version number. Okay, then what do you think will happen in this case?
The quorum will agree on an older file version and then.
Okay, so in this case, let's say you pick A, B, C, E, F, G, H. Okay, so what do you think is going to happen in this case? With the version numbers, will they match or not?
Not.
Okay, they shouldn't match because A, B, C, E, F, G have not seen the write. It only went to these servers. And H has seen the write. So H, version number returned by H will be greater than the version number returned by those other files. Okay, so it won't match. So read will fail. You'll pick another 7 servers. Okay, what will happen then?
Always it will.
Okay, so what you have to realize is there is no way to pick 7 servers here such that you will get matching because only 6 servers have seen the write at all. So even if you pick these 6 servers and pick one of these other ones, that one will disagree with you. Okay, so in this case, no reads are going to succeed at all. Okay, so which means safety is ensured. You will never get an old version, but you don't get a property what you want, which is called liveness, which is that you want to actually read. You don't have to keep asking and never succeed. Okay, so you will not violate safety properties, which is safety property means nothing bad happens. That's called safety. Liveness means something good happens. Okay, so liveness in this case means the read will actually succeed. Safety will mean read will never return you some old version. Okay, so you get safety property, but you don't get liveness property. And you should ask why is the case. What did we do that actually got us? Yes.
NW is not greater than half of the servers.
Okay. So I said that to have the right property, you have to follow these two rules. NW has to be strict majority. We picked 6 out of 12. That's not strict majority. That's half. Okay. Which is why we are getting stuck because you cannot actually find the right number of servers to do something. Okay. So if you are, because we picked this to be 6, we are having this problem. So NW actually has to be at least 7. That's the first thing. Now NR shouldn't be, NR plus NW also has to be greater than N. Otherwise you will again have the same problem. Okay, so in particular in the previous case, if you had picked the read quorum to be 2, okay, you could have picked A and B. Those could have an old version, they agree and you might actually get an old one. But then 10 plus 2 is not strictly greater than 12. 10 plus 2 is equal to 12. Okay? So you have to pick your read and write quorums carefully to ensure both safety and liveness are both going to be achieved. Okay? So that's why you have to follow those two rules, and that will give you strict majority, and the read plus write quorum has to exceed N for you to ensure that you will agree. Okay? Here's a special case, okay, where you can actually just send a read request to exactly one server, okay, and you are guaranteed to always get the most recent write. you set the read quorum to be 1. Okay? If you set the read quorum to be 1, by definition, you will only get one version number and the read has to proceed because you are not even comparing it. Okay? And you want to guarantee that that's the most recent version. So if you want to do a read quorum of 1, the only way you are going to do this is the write quorum has to be the entire set. Otherwise, there's no way you can just go to an arbitrary server and that server has the most recent write. So you will see in this case, NR is 1, but the write quorum is set to the whole set. Okay, it also satisfies NR, NW is greater than 6, and NR plus NW is greater than 4. Yes, question.
In these three examples, NR plus NW is always N plus 1. Is that an optimal allocation, or certainly it's the minimum?
So question is, in all of these three examples, NR plus NW is actually N plus 1, which in this case is 13, and the question is that optimal or is that the minimum? It just happens to be the minimum for correctness. Okay? There is no such thing as optimal, but you can think of the overhead. The more servers you have to talk to for doing reads or writes, the more the overhead of sending messages. So you want to ensure that you pick them in a way that somehow minimizes your read or write overhead. Okay? In particular, this one is called read one, write all, which means you write to all the server, you read from one. And this is a good design point to pick if you have very read intensive application. If you are read intensive, then the best thing you can do is optimize your reads to move as fast as possible. The way you are going to optimize your read is saying go just pick any server, read, and you're done. Don't have to talk to multiple servers, ask them to vote or anything like that. Okay? So if reads are frequent, writes are rare, you're going to pay the price of saying writes are rare, let's just send the write to every server. Okay, it will be more expensive than a subset, but you will win because your reads are now very, very cheap. You go to any one server, you're done. Okay, so you can optimize based on the overheads, okay, of what you are trying to achieve. Is this clear? Any questions on this? Yes.
I think you might have explained what I meant to most investors. So it's so if suppose a client is writing to this cluster probably. So is the write done multiple times via the client, or does the client randomly select one? I know that there is no primary, but then we can just select something like round robin, and that can distribute the writes like an epidemic.
So the question is, who is responsible for who doing the write? Does the write actually know the presence of the servers, the client rather, know the presence of the server? Does it have to pick at random, or does it go through some other intermediate? So that's up to the implementation. You could certainly have a proxy sitting in front of this and all the reads and writes go to the proxy and the proxy is dealing with this in the back end, so you don't have to deal with all of that. You can also expose all of that to the client, but the client file system, not the application. Okay, the client file system might be doing this inside the operating system kernel. So what you do, what is exposed, depends on specific applications and implementation. But generally, you don't want the application programmer to be doing this. You don't want to be actually picking N servers or N R servers and doing N writes or having N write statements in your code. That doesn't make any sense at all. That's too complicated. So you want to do it either in a runtime system, in a middleware, or the OS. If not, put this burden on the application program. Yes, question.
In example A,
yep.
Does a write that went to C through L ever get propagated to A and B?
Okay, the question is, once you have made a write to the write quorum, is the write going to propagate to the rest of the servers that were not picked as part of the quorum? In this case, you don't have to propagate the writes at all. Okay, you could, but you don't have to. All you need to do is pick NW and then be done with it. Okay, then just so you are assuming that some servers will not get picked every time a write happens, and those servers will have an outdated copy, but everyone in the write quorum has one. Okay, if you want to propagate the write, you're better off just picking the write quorum to be the entire set to begin with. Then you don't have to do any extra work. By definition, every write has gone to all the servers. Okay? Any other questions? All right, so that, I'm actually going to switch gears and start a new topic. So I finished consistency and replication. And when we were talking about replication, I said there are two issues we'll look at. Okay, whenever you replicate data, you have to worry about how you can keep it consistent with respect to one another. I also said replication can also help us achieve fault tolerance. If some copies fail, then you can have other replicas step in and continue to perform the job. So for the rest of today's class and the next class on Wednesday, I'm going to talk about issues related to fault tolerance. Okay, so here we'll start with some simple ideas, but then we'll talk about this notion of distributed commit. We'll talk about consensus. We'll talk about Paxos, if you've heard of this algorithm called Paxos. So we'll go through all of those issues in the next this class and in the next class. Okay, so that's an outline. We're going to start at the top, okay, with some definitions of fault tolerance and so on. Okay, so essentially our idea here is we are in a distributed system. If you have a single machine system or a centralized system, if the machine fails, then the entire application stops. There's nothing you can do because the machine is itself going down. Okay, so OS crashes, disk crashes can bring down your entire system. In a distributed system, okay, if you have independent nodes that are independent, if some nodes fail, the other nodes can take over their task and the application as a whole can continue to run. Okay, if you design the application well, so that there are no single points of failures. If you have single points of failure, even in a distributed system, okay, if that single point of failure goes down for any reason, then you are in trouble. Okay? Now our question here is, what can we do to ensure fault tolerance, to ensure that the system continues to run? Okay? And we'll look at some techniques to do that. Now the other flip side of what we want to also look at is that in a large distributed system, you have no choice but to actually implement fault tolerance techniques. Okay? In a centralized system, you could assume, okay, failures are rare, my blog is going to run on one machine and maybe it may crash once in a while, but I can tolerate that it's not very frequent. Okay? And it's okay because there's one machine, if it is a reasonably built machine, it may not crash. But if you have a distributed system with n nodes, okay, and let's say P is the probability of a failure of any given node, okay, it could be a small probability, it doesn't matter. Okay? But if you have one node, then the probability that there is any failure in this system is going to be this, at least one failure, 1 minus P to the power n. Okay? That comes from simple probability, but now imagine what's going to happen as n grows. Okay, so as n grows larger and larger, in particular when n grows to infinity, what is the probability that there is at least one failed node in the system, which is 1 minus p to the power n? Okay, what does that trend to?
Very little, like it will be minimal, the probability, right? Because p is going to be very huge.
P is a fraction, it's the opposite.
Opposite,
right? So p could be any value less than 1, that's the probability of a failure. As p to the power n goes to infinity, this term is going to tend to 0. This whole term is going to trend to 1. Okay, what that is also telling you is a very simple way analysis is telling you that in large systems, failures is a common case. It's not no longer an uncommon case. Okay? As your system grows larger and larger, there will always be some subset of the components that are down for any reason. So if you do not implement your application on this large system with fault tolerance techniques, you are going to have problems. So when your systems grow larger and larger, fault tolerance considerations become integral to system design. It's not an option. In a centralized system, you can say, okay, I don't care, I'll just back up my data. If it crashes, I'll do something. In this case, you have to actually make sure that you can take over the responsibility of field nodes and so on. Okay, so that's essentially what this is saying. Probability of a failure is the probability that any one component fails, which is probability of 1 minus p of no failure, which is basically everything I said here. Okay. Now, a slightly different perspective of having said fault tolerance is important, you have to also think about how software systems have evolved. Okay. Software systems in general are not very reliable. Okay. You have any large piece of software, even when you ship it, it basically ships with some bugs or the other. It's not never bug-free. So the assumption is that occasionally users will do something that will trigger a bug, it might cause the system to crash, but you tolerate it, the users tolerate it because that's the way you are accustomed to dealing with software. Okay, so every once in a while your machine, my laptop may hang. What do you do? and you reboot. And you say, okay, now it's restarted, so I'm actually agree or vote on what is the right thing to do, and based on that you will actually decide, okay, this is the right version. Okay, so the simplest thing we can assume for example to understand this example is that there is a single file that is replicated across n nodes. Okay, every time you update the file, you increment a version number. The file has a version number. Okay, and every time you increment the file, you update the version number. The version number could simply be the last modification timestamp on the file. That's a version number. Okay, but for simplicity, we'll just assume it's an integer version number. It doesn't really matter what the version number is. And our goal is to ensure that when you try to read a file, you will get the latest copy. Okay. So that's what I said here. Yeah, consider a file replicated on n servers. You want to now read or write. And every read request for this, because there's no primary, every read request is going to go to some subset of the servers. Okay, and we'll define this notion of a quorum. Okay, we'll have a read quorum and a write quorum. Okay, so if you have a read quorum of, let's say, 3, okay, let's say you just say read quorum is 3 servers, that means every read request has to be sent to 3 of the n servers in the system. And those 3 servers have to agree on this is the most recent version of the file and give you that version. Okay. And in the write quorum, let's say you have a write quorum of n, okay, or n is the total number of servers, let's say write quorum is nw, you are going to send a write request to nw servers every time they all have to perform the write. Okay, I'm going to show you an example in the next slide. And to ensure consistency, so I'm going to talk about a protocol called the Giffords quorum protocol. And what this protocol says is that you can't pick your read quorum and write quorum arbitrarily. If you want to ensure consistency, you have to follow these two rules. Okay? This says that the write quorum has to be a strict majority. Okay, if you have n servers in the system, every write has to go to more than n over 2. Okay? You can pick any number greater than n over 2. So it has to be a strict majority, okay, to ensure consistency. So if you have 10 servers, okay, each write has to be performed at least 6 servers. So if you pick 6 as your write quorum, every write request will go to 6 servers. Okay, and all those 6 servers will then have the most recent version of the file. Okay. So that's what the write quorum says. And then it says, given a write quorum that you have chosen, you have to pick your read quorum such that nr plus nw exceeds n. Okay, so I'll show you some examples of how to do this. So essentially, when you do a write, you will then contact NW servers and get them to do an update. When you do a read, you essentially contact any NR servers in the pool and say, what's the most recent version number you have? And if the version number agrees, then you say, okay, they have the most recent. It's guaranteed that that's the most recent version of the file. Okay, and here is an example just to make us understand this a little better. Okay, so we have servers A through L, okay, 12 servers in our pool. Okay, let's just assume there's one file that is replicated on all 12 servers. Every time you update a file, you increment a version number, which is a timestamp, could be an integer timestamp. Okay. To read, okay, you have to contact NR servers and say, what's the timestamp that you have? Then they'll each tell you the timestamp. If the timestamps agree, you are guaranteed that that's the most recent version. The timestamp disagree, okay, then you repeat. You find another NR servers until you find all NR servers that are in agreement. Okay, so that's, and then to write, you're going to send your write request to NW servers and they'll just make an update. Okay, so here are several scenarios. Okay, the first scenario, we pick the read quorum to be 3. Okay, we pick the write quorum to be 10. Okay, what that means is every write request has to go to 10 arbitrarily chosen server out of 12. You can pick any 10 out of 12. You send the write request there. Okay, and then those servers will perform the write. To do a read, you have to pick any 3 servers. Okay, if those 3 and say, what's the version you have? If those 3 servers return you all identical version numbers, you are guaranteed now that your file is actually up to date. If not, then you'll repeat. Okay, and here is an example. So this dotted box here shows you the write quorum for the most recent write. So other than A and B, all the other servers have seen the most recent version. A and B haven't seen it, which means they have some old data. Okay, they didn't see the write. Okay. So to do a read, you pick A, B, and C. And you said, what's the most recent version do you have? A and B are going to send you some old version number, and C is going to send you a new version number. Okay, version numbers won't match, because A and B did not see the write. So you will see this, I cannot actually proceed because they don't agree. The voting has failed. Okay, so you will repeat. You will find another three servers at random. Okay, if you happen to pick three servers in this dotted pool, you will get agreement because all those servers have seen the most recent, right? They will give you the same version number. And you are guaranteed that if the version number agrees, that's the most recent version. So you will just read and you will be done. Okay? So you will see that this has a safety thing built in. Because you picked the read and write quorum this way, there's never a way you can actually go and read and find NR servers that all agree, but you still get an old version. Okay? To do that, you have to follow these two rules. If you don't, then you will actually not get that property, which is the write quorum has to be strict majority, NR plus NW has to be greater than N. Okay? And I'll give you another example where you might actually see this problem. So in this case, NW is 6. Okay, so you picked half the servers out of 12 to perform your write. NR is set to 7. Okay? So again, the dotted set of servers are the ones that you performed the write on. Okay, so essentially I, J, K, L, H, and D have seen the write. Okay, you now pick 7 servers and you ask for the file version number. Okay, then what do you think will happen in this case?
The quorum will agree on an older file version and then...
Okay, so in this case, let's say you picked A, B, C, E, F, G, H. Okay, so what do you think is going to happen in this case? With the version numbers, will they match or not?
Not match.
Okay, they shouldn't match because A, B, C, E, F, G have not seen the write. It only went to these servers. And H has seen the write. So H, version number returned by H will be greater than the version number returned by those other files. Okay, so it won't match. So read will fail. You'll pick another 7 servers. Okay, what will happen then? Okay, so what you have to realize is there is no way to pick 7 servers here such that you'll get matching because only 6 servers have seen the write at all. So even if you pick these 6 servers and pick one of these other ones, that one will disagree with you. Okay? So in this case, no reads are going to succeed at all. Okay, so which means safety is ensured. You'll never get an old version, but you don't get a property what you want, which is called liveness, which is that you want to actually read. You don't have to keep asking and never succeed. Okay, so you will not violate safety properties. Which safety property means nothing bad happens. That's called safety. Liveness means something good happens. Okay, so liveness in this case means the read will actually succeed. Safety will mean read will never return you some old version. Okay, so you get safety property, but you don't get liveness property. And you should ask why is the case. What did we do that actually got us? Yes.
NW is not greater than half of the servers.
Okay. So I said that to have the right properties, you have to follow these two rules. NW has to be strict majority. We picked 6 out of 12. That's not strict majority. That's half. Okay. Which is why we are getting stuck because you cannot actually find the right number of servers to do something. Okay. So if you are, because we picked this to be 6, we are having this problem. Okay. So NW actually has to be at least 7. That's the first thing. Now NR shouldn't be, NR plus NW also has to be greater than N. Otherwise you will again have the same problem. Okay, so in particular in the previous case, if you had picked the read quorum to be 2, okay, you could have picked A and B. Those could have an old version, they agree and you might actually get an old one. But then 10 plus 2 is not strictly greater than 12. 10 plus 2 is equal to 12. Okay? So you have to pick your read and write quorums carefully to ensure both safety and liveness are both going to be achieved. Okay? So that's why you have to follow those two rules, and that will give you strict majority, and the read plus write quorum has to exceed N for you to ensure that you will agree. Okay? Here's a special case, okay, where you can actually just send a read request to exactly one server, okay, and you are guaranteed to always get the most recent write. Okay, you set the read quorum to be 1. Okay? If you set the read quorum to be 1, by definition, you will only get one version number and the read has to proceed because you are not even comparing it. Okay? And you want to guarantee that that's the most recent version. So if you want to do a read quorum of 1, the only way you are going to do this is the write quorum has to be the entire set. Otherwise, there's no way you can just go to an arbitrary server and that server has the most recent write. So you will see in this case, NR is 1, but the write quorum is set to the whole set. Okay, it also satisfies NR, NW is greater than 6, and NR plus NW is greater than 12. Yes, question.
In these three examples, NR plus NW is always N plus 1. Is that an optimal allocation, or certainly it's the minimum?
So question is, in all of these three examples, NR plus NW is actually N plus 1, which in this case is 13, and the question is that optimal or is that the minimum? It just happens to be the minimum for correctness. Okay? There is no such thing as optimal, but you can think of the overhead. The more servers you have to talk to for doing reads or writes, the more the overhead of sending messages. So you want to ensure that you pick them in a way that somehow minimizes your read or write overhead. Okay? In particular, this one is called read one, write all, which means you write to all the server, you read from one. And this is a good design point to pick if you have very read intensive application. If you are read intensive, then the best thing you can do is optimize your reads to move as fast as possible. The way you are going to optimize your read is saying go just pick any server, read, and you're done. Don't have to talk to multiple servers, ask them to vote or anything like that. Okay? So if reads are frequent, writes are rare, you're going to pay the price of saying writes are rare, let's just send the write to every server. Okay, it will be more expensive than a subset, but you will win because your reads are now very, very cheap. You go to any one server, you're done. Okay, so you can optimize based on the overheads, okay, of what you are trying to achieve. Is this clear? Any questions on this? Yes.
I think you might have explained what I meant to most investors. So it's so if suppose a client is writing to this cluster probably. So is the write done multiple times via the client, or does the client randomly select one? I know that there is no primary, but then we can just select something like round robin, and that can distribute the writes like an epidemic.
So the question is, who is responsible for who doing the write? Does the write actually know the presence of the servers, the client rather, know the presence of the server? Does it have to pick at random, or does it go through some other intermediate? So that's up to the implementation. You could certainly have a proxy sitting in front of this and all the reads and writes go to the proxy and the proxy is dealing with this in the back end, so you don't have to deal with all of that. You can also expose all of that to the client, but the client file system, not the application. Okay, the client file system might be doing this inside the operating system kernel. So what you do, what is exposed, depends on specific applications and implementation. But generally, you don't want the application programmer to be doing this. You don't want to be actually picking N servers or N R servers and doing N writes or having N write statements in your code. That doesn't make any sense at all. That's too complicated. So you want to do it either in a runtime system, in a middleware, or the OS. If not, put this burden on the application program. Yes, question.
In example A,
yeah.
Does a write that went to C through L ever get propagated to A and B?
Okay, the question is, once you have made a write to the write quorum, is the write going to propagate to the rest of the servers that were not picked as part of the quorum? In this case, you don't have to propagate the writes at all. Okay, you could, but you don't have to. All you need to do is pick NW and then be done with it. Okay, then just so you are assuming that some servers will not get picked every time a write happens, and those servers will have an outdated copy, but everyone in the write quorum has one. Okay, if you want to propagate the write, you're better off just picking the write quorum to be the entire set to begin with. Then you don't have to do any extra work. By definition, every write has gone to all the servers. Okay? Any other questions? All right, so that, I'm actually going to switch gears and start a new topic. So I finished consistency and replication. And when we were talking about replication, I said there are two issues we'll look at. Okay, whenever you replicate data, you have to worry about how you can keep it consistent with respect to one another. I also said replication can also help us achieve fault tolerance. If some copies fail, then you can have other replicas step in and continue to perform the job. So for the rest of today's class and the next class on Wednesday, I'm going to talk about issues related to fault tolerance. Okay, so here we'll start with some simple ideas, but then we'll talk about this notion of distributed commit. We'll talk about consensus. We'll talk about Paxos, if you've heard of this algorithm called Paxos. So we'll go through all of those issues in the next this class and in the next class. Okay, so that's an outline. We're going to start at the top, okay, with some definitions of fault tolerance and so on. Okay, so essentially our idea here is we are in a distributed system. If you have a single machine system or a centralized system, if the machine fails, then the entire application stops. There's nothing you can do because the machine is itself going down. Okay, so OS crashes, disk crashes can bring down your entire system. In a distributed system, okay, if you have independent nodes that are independent, if some nodes fail, the other nodes can take over their task and the application as a whole can continue to run. Okay, if you design the application well, so that there are no single points of failures. If you have single points of failure, even in a distributed system, okay, if that single point of failure goes down for any reason, then you are in trouble. Okay? Now our question here is, what can we do to ensure fault tolerance, to ensure that the system continues to run? Okay, and we'll look at some techniques to do that. Now the other flip side of what we want to also look at is that in a large distributed system, you have no choice but to actually implement fault tolerance techniques. Okay? In a centralized system, you could assume, okay, failures are rare, my blog is going to run on one machine and maybe it may crash once in a while, but I can tolerate that it's not very frequent. Okay? And it's okay because there's one machine, if it is a reasonably built machine, it may not crash. But if you have a distributed system with n nodes, okay, and let's say P is the probability of a failure of any given node, okay, it could be a small probability, it doesn't matter. Okay? But if you have one node, then the probability that there is any failure in this system is going to be this, at least one failure, 1 minus P to the power n. Okay? That comes from simple probability, but now imagine what's going to happen as n grows. Okay, so as n grows larger and larger, in particular when n grows to infinity, what is the probability that there is at least one failed node in the system, which is 1 minus p to the power n? Okay, what does that trend do?
Very little, like it will be minimal, the probability, right? Because p is going to be very huge.
P is a fraction, it's the opposite.
Right?
So p could be any value less than 1, that's the probability of a failure. As p to the power n goes to infinity, this term is going to tend to 0. This whole term is going to trend to 1. Okay, what that is also telling you is a very simple way analysis that's telling you that in large systems, failures is a common case. It's not no longer an uncommon case. Okay? As your system grows larger and larger, there will always be some subset of the components that are down for any reason. So if you do not implement your application on this large system with fault tolerance techniques, you are going to have problems. So when your systems grow larger and larger, fault tolerance considerations become integral to system design. It's not an option. In a centralized system, you can say, okay, I don't care, I'll just back up my data. If it crashes, I'll do something. In this case, you have to actually make sure that you can take over the responsibility of field nodes and so on. Okay, so that's essentially what this is saying. Probability of a failure is the probability that any one component fails, which is probability of 1 minus p of no failure, which is basically everything I said here. Okay. Now, a slightly different perspective of having said fault tolerance is important, you have to also think about how software systems have evolved. Okay. Software systems in general are not very reliable. Okay. You have any large piece of software, even when you ship it, it basically ships with some bugs or the other. It's not never bug-free. So the assumption is that occasionally users will do something that will trigger a bug, it might cause the system to crash, but you tolerate it, the users tolerate it because that's the way you are accustomed to dealing with software. Okay, so every once in a while your machine, my laptop may hang. What do? Then you reboot. And you say, okay, now it's restarted. So I'm one bit message. Let's say you're sending one or a zero, and you want to agree. Okay, so let's think in the army case. Let's say General 1 sent a messenger to General 2. Okay, how would you know that the messenger actually reached and delivered the message? What would you do?
You send so many messengers.
You send
one messenger first. And one, you just assume one might reach. I mean, like the server faults. If you
keep sending messengers, you don't know whether any of them have reached at all, because you don't know. Or if they deliver different messages, the other general will not know what is the right thing to do. So you want to reach agreement, which means that you want to agree on a time, and both parties need to know that each the other party has actually agreed to that time. That is called agreement in this case. So what is the thing you could do? So a messenger goes from, let's say, General 1 to General 2, delivers the message. What's the simplest thing you can do to know that your messenger reached?
You send one back.
That's called an acknowledgement in network case.
Yeah.
So you tell the messenger, after you reach there, ask the other general, sign the message and come back. So if the messenger actually reaches there and brings back your signed message, okay, you know that your message was delivered successfully. Okay? Now, is this enough for us to say both generals now are ready to attack? And both generals know that?
No, because the Byzantine could send a false messenger acknowledgement back.
Right. So, when the messenger is making a reverse trip back, okay, the general that signed the message doesn't know that the messenger has actually reached successfully. You don't know if your acknowledgement went back, because acknowledgement could be captured or dropped, or it could be flipped. Okay? So how is the second general to know that the messenger reached?
It's like a two-way acknowledgement.
Okay, you can send an acknowledgement to the acknowledgement. Okay, the second messenger will reach there. Okay, take the signed message and say, okay, now you sign that you received your original message signed, and you traverse back. Okay. So now, how is the first general to know that the second general has received your acknowledgement, acknowledgement, and say, okay, now both of us know that we are going to attack at 6 a.m.
But why does he need to know?
Okay, so this is a recursive problem that will never reach solution. Because every time you send a message, you don't know if that message made it. You need an acknowledgement back and app, you don't know. So you can never reach agreement in this case. Okay, that's what is said here, actually. The answer is, two perfect processes can never reach agreement in the presence of an unreliable channel, because we'll keep sending acts for acts, and you never know whether the previous message reached. Okay, and you'll only know, only when both parties know that the message has been received by both ends successfully, will you know this. The only way to do this is to send another message. That message has the same problem as the previous one. Okay, so what this says is, if there are two generals with unreliable hostile territory, you will never actually reach agreement. Okay, so that's the problem that you cannot solve. So we won't try to solve it, but we won't do it. But now we will try to relax the problem. So let's assume that it's not that the territory is hostile, but let's assume that one of the generals is a traitor. Okay, so basically that among all the N generals, one, at least one or more generals are traitors. Okay, they are actually going to subvert your plans. Okay? So you want the remaining generals to actually reach agreement, saying, we know that there are some traitors. We don't know who the traitors are, but can the rest of us agree to actually finding a common time to attack our enemy? How do you do that? So the real problem in the Byzantine days, because there were some generals that were traitors, and if you're trying to send a message, you don't know what's going on. Who to trust, who to not trust is not clear. Yet you want the trusted ones to somehow agree to something, saying, let's do this, let's plan on something. Okay? This problem is called a Byzantine general problem. Okay? The problem is, can N generals reach agreement with a perfect channel? In this case, we will assume that the network is perfect. We'll use TCP/IP. Okay? So that you will get your messages across. So that's not a problem. We'll assume that network is not acting in a Byzantine fashion, it's the generals, the processes themselves that are faulty, not the network. Okay? And we'll assume M out of N generals could be traitors. How do you reach agreement in this case? Okay, that's the problem. I'm going to show you a round-based algorithm which will allow us to figure out not only who is the traitor, but also have the rest of them reach agreement and identify the traitor, if one needs to be identified. Okay, so here is, and this is a recursive algorithm designed by Leslie Lamport. Yes, we'll encounter Lamport's algorithms over and over again. So this is one more. Okay. So what happens in this round-based protocol is in each round, you are going to send some message. Okay, let's say rather than agreeing, just to make it simple, rather than agreeing to the time of the attack, you send how many soldiers you have to all the other generals. It doesn't matter what you're trying to agree on, I'm just making it simple. So you are sending your troop strength in terms of number of kilo soldiers. How many thousands of soldiers do you have? So in round one, let's say for simplicity, we are going to assume that general one has 1,000 soldiers, two has 2,000, three has 3,000, and four has 4,000. So each of you has to send messages one, two, three, and four, that's your troop strength. Okay? So one is going to announce his troop strength by sending a message one to all the other three. Okay? Two is going to send a message labeled two to the other three. Three is the faulty process. It can do whatever it wants. Okay. It can send three to all of them, it can send a different message to all of them. Yeah, so it will basically, so we will assume that it sends arbitrary messages. So in some sense, we'll say it will send message X, Y, and Z, that they're arbitrary variables. Okay, and those variables could take any value because V is Byzantine fault, 3 is Byzantine fault. So 3 has sent X, Y, and Z, and 4 is going to send 4 to everyone. Okay. So at the end of the first round, okay, if you see what messages each general has received, general 1 has gotten a message 1 from itself, 2 from 2, x from 3, and 4 from 4. Okay? And 2 has gotten 1, 2, y, 4, 3 can, 3 is actually going to get the right one because it knows itself, and we don't care what it gets. 4 gets 1, 2, z, and 4. Okay? So that's some information you have at the end of round 1. Okay? You are going to now recursively repeat. You are going to take whatever you received in the previous round and broadcast that to everyone. Okay? So one is going to send a message saying, I got this vector at the end of this round, 1 to x, 4 to everyone else. Okay? 2 is going to send 1 to y, 4, 3 can send any arbitrary value again. So let's say it sends A, B, C, D or something along these lines, and then 4 sends this. Okay? At the end of the second round, this is what you get. Okay? 1 is going to get 1, 2, y, 4. Okay? A, B, C, D, and 1, 2, Z, 4 from the other three. Okay? 2 gets 1, 2, X, 4, okay? E, F, G, H, 1, 2, Z, 4, and 4 gets that. Okay? Now the question is, based on this, can you actually figure out who is the traitor and agree on what the rest of the generals actually sent you?
Just
yes.
One question. So when 3 is sending, he is basically mutating 1, 2, 3, 4, and sending different for each.
Yes. Yes. Because 3 can do whatever it wants. So we'll assume it sends a variable A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I, J, K, L. That could take any arbitrary value. Doesn't matter what it is. It could be the right values. It could send this, or it could send garbage. It could send different values to different processes. Doesn't matter. Okay, we'll say do whatever you want. We can still try to reach agreement. Okay, so now if you analyze what has happened at the end of the second round, one says, okay, I can see that my message was received successfully. So essentially you can look at this and say, 3 is the one that is actually sending bad messages. Everyone else is actually agreeing, okay, because I'm getting the right things from 1 and 2, 2 and 4. Okay, 2 says I'm getting the right thing from 1 and 4, but 3 is sending arbitrary messages. So if you see the row and the column, you'll see those are the ones that don't seem to be matching. Everyone else is consistent. Okay? And so on. So at the end of the second round, these four generals can actually figure out that 3 is actually a traitor in this case, if 3 actually send malicious messages, and the rest of them will can be trusted, and they will basically agree on what the rest of them. Okay. Now, if you think about it, what you've simply done is every general is asking three others. Okay, and if one of them is a traitor, the other two will agree. So you're simply saying, I know I can be trusted. Of the remaining three, I don't know who to trust. But if two of you tell me the same response, the third one is lying, I can immediately figure that out. Okay, because you are essentially, the truthful generals are outvoting the lying generals in this case. Okay. So what this is also showing is if you want to deal with one Byzantine faulty process, you actually need four redundancy of four. Okay. In this case, you have four generals. Okay. You have to replicate your system four times to deal with one Byzantine fault, as opposed to, so you are, rather than just having one replica, you need four replicas to deal with one failure, which is four times the cost. If you want to deal with one server failure, you have to invest four times the hardware, four times the software, which is a very high cost. Okay, so essentially for K failures, you need 3K plus 1. Yes, question.
If 3 is faulty, and it's set, but it instead of sending different values for X, Y, and Z, it's not malicious, it's just wrong, and it sends the same incorrect value for X, Y, and Z. Will this recognize that?
So question is, if 3 is sending the same wrong value, will it recognize that? So in this case, if you send the same value over and over again, you will basically just assume that that's the value you sent. The others will agree. So if this was, if you asked a question to everyone, what is 2 plus 2? Okay? And 3 is sending 2 plus 2 is equal to 5 to everyone, but everyone else is saying 4, you can identify that 2 is wrong. Right? So I basically, so in reality, these are servers that are processing requests, and the request will produce a response. It could be a database query that produces, or it could be a computation that produces a single integer. You produce the same wrong value, the others will outvote you still. Okay? Any other questions here? Okay. So if you do the Byzantine general problem with the same example, with just three generals, not two, okay, you will see that this, in this case, you cannot actually figure out what is going on. Okay? And there's a round-based approach here. So after the first round, you get 1, 2x, 1, 2y, 1, 2, 3. And then you essentially get 1, 2y, A, B, C. You get 1, 2x, D, E, F. So you get two values from the other two. Okay? But you don't know which one to trust. So the way to think about this is, let's say you have two friends, okay, and you ask them a question. You know one of them is lying. Okay? You don't know which one is lying, which one is a traitor. Okay? So I'll give you two different responses. You don't know which is the right response. Okay? Same thing is true here. From the perspective of each general, okay, from the perspective of general two, one is telling you something and three is telling you something. You don't know which one to trust. And they're telling you there how many troops they have. Yeah, and you know one of them is wrong, but you don't know. And then same from the perspective of two. So what this is saying is that if your M faulty processes, agreement is possible only if 2M plus 1 processes correctly function. Okay? So if M is equal to 1, then you essentially need 4 processes. You plug in 4 processes and you can tolerate one fault. If you have only 3 processes and one of them is Byzantine faulty, they cannot reach agreement because they cannot distinguish who is lying. You can actually find that there is a fault because you know that there is different answers coming, but you don't know which is the right answer. So you can detect that there is a fault, but you don't know what the right answer is. In the previous case, you can not only detect the fault, but you can also find the right answer because there are 4 processes from every general's perspective. If one of the other three is faulty, 2 of them will outvote the other. Okay, so you have enough of a majority vote to do this. Okay, so just to recap, we are running out of time for today. So detecting a faulty process is easier. You only need 2K plus 1 processes. That's the previous example. If all you wanted to know is there is a fault, this is good enough. If you want to detect the fault and correct for it, which is reaching agreement, then that is harder. You need 3K plus 1 processes. Okay. Now notice that the number of replicas you need has massively gone up. If there are simple crash failures, you only needed K plus 1. In particular, if K was 1, you needed 2 servers for every one faulty server. In this case, you might need up to 4 servers for every fault. Okay, and so that's a very high level of redundancy and high cost. So most practical system, no one is willing to pay 4 times the cost to deal with one fault. So the hardware costs go up, storage costs go up, network costs go up. Okay, and so you have the same how to deal with this problem. So the implication on real systems is, although there is a lot of Byzantine fault tolerance theory, okay, BFT, which is the acronym for Byzantine fault tolerance, now not used in many practical systems because it's just too expensive to use. In most cases, you say, okay, I'm going to deal with crash failures, and that's the extent. If there are Byzantine faults, there's a security hack and this kind of stuff happens, I will have to deal with that separately. System is not designed to handle that, but that's just too expensive. Okay, you just deal with that, not using your design principles, to deal with that using offline methods. Okay, so I'm going to stop here today. Next time we'll talk about Paxos and other consensus protocol. For those of you who came late, I made an announcement at the beginning, which is that on Friday, I'm going to have a makeup class to make up for that one lecture I missed last week, okay, in this room at 9 o'clock.